Hello all, and welcome to episode 12 of Enterprise Tech India Unplugged. And today we have with us Kumaran, who is the chief mentor of Tiny Magic. How are you doing, Kumaran?
Pretty good, actually.
So with all this lockdown, there's a lot of, I would say, idle horse running is happening in the background where people are thinking of new stuff and trying new things every day. So what I thought of was to bring out a topic which has been of interest to me for a long time is why is the large scale India based success stories of IT or technology companies not become apparent, even though we are the back end operations for, or even technology innovations for a lot of large technology companies, including Amazon and Microsoft and Google and you name it, right? So everybody worth the name in the technology world has operations and innovation centers based in India. And it's not just because we have cheap labor, because it is definitely that we are providing value in terms of new capabilities and in terms of intellectual capital which we are providing. So my question is, Kumaran, why is it that we don't see so many success stories?
It's a decade-old question, Deepak. It starts from why can't... when I joined Wipro in 97, we had our company meeting. And the same question popped up to Premji. Okay, mm-hmm. So 97 means what? 22 years ago. Okay. Mm-hmm. It's sad, it's ironic that the question is still valid today. Okay. Now, one of the things which I kind of realized sometime back, we were talking, is that in China, they are able to come up with Baidu and things like that, right? TikTok or Tencent games and things like that. Probably, I think what helped them is their IT had to develop products from scratch to deal with the customer's problem. Now, what had happened is the world had identified a problem, okay, that a common man faces, and some existing companies had solved that problem, whether it's Facebook or search, like that, okay. But China said you cannot use that from a governmental perspective. Mm-hmm. So what happened is each of the companies had to solve that problem from scratch, okay. And by doing that, they built that capability to identify problems, how to work around it, and how to... They didn't do a control C, control V. Now, this is one thing which China did smartly. Mm-hmm. They didn't copy Facebook. They didn't copy Google. Okay. They went and then said, what is that equivalent problem which faces in my China? What's the equivalent of search? What's the equivalent problem of Facebook that I need to handle? Okay. Mm-hmm. So they didn't do a control C, control V. So they tried to see the localized version of that problem, and mm-hmm. they developed a localized solution, which means it's a different from Facebook or Baidu. It might look similar on top, but at the bottom, it's not there. For mm-hmm. example, good or bad, most of these solutions have security baked in from day one, mm-hmm. monitoring and security. Correct?
Yeah, means the big brother is built into it.
Yeah, so the big brother is the first feature that they will implement. Big brother's wishes will be met, then the small brother's wishes can be met. Okay? And now, because of that, they have developed that product mindset. Or rather, that's too generic. Let me sell it that they have developed a problem-solving mindset. Mm-hmm. So they have developed a nose for problems. Mm-hmm. Out comes something like PUBG. PUBG has taken over the world like that, right? Mm-hmm. What's the promotion for that? Because, you know, what's the key thing to a problem? Why is PUBG even more popular than Xbox or PS3, which has been there so much time? Right. They did one very simple thing. I have a 3,000 rupee phone. Can I game on it? They solved mm-hmm. that problem. Mm-hmm. None of the US companies did that. Mm-hmm. Okay. And China's scale and volume gives them how to handle huge volumes at a lower cost. Mm-hmm. That's what makes them magical. Alibaba, same case, right? Mm-hmm. Okay, so they know how to solve problems at scale. Mm-hmm. as a community. Okay, so if you look at India's intellectual capability, okay, versus theirs, I would say their capability is towards solving mass problems at scale with economies working. They have that built into their DNA. So, and then it becomes an ecosystem, right? Somebody who has worked in Baidu for, let's say, 10 years. Now, it's like second nature to him to think, how do I build a million user application? Somebody who's worked that module lead there, he thinks itself, how will this scale when they write a feature? It's become baked into their DNA. Okay. And it's not that I will want a big servers. No, they'll say, how do I do it cheaper also?
Right.
How do I do it next to free?
Okay. Right.
Now, I'm just telling how they built that. Okay. Mm-hmm. Now, India, at some point, had this. That's why you had the likes of HCL, Wipro, and all making their own hardware.
Right.
Wipro had their own Excel software. Because that was the time when regiments were there. IBM got kicked out. Coke got kicked out. Okay.
Yes.
And then we started making our own Thumbs Up or
Limca,
Goldspot, Goldspot, our own hardware, everything like that, right? But then what happened is when that thing was removed, right, we switched to services. We started doing a Control C, Control V. I think that's where we lost the plot. Now, this is at a very high level from a regimental and an environmental perspective. Okay. But if you look at it as an individual thing, now double clicking this, what happens is in a services mind, in the HypoHa framework, what we call is we are action oriented thinking. We are working for specific results. Okay. Whereas if you take Israel or companies in China or in US, they are in an intention oriented. They have an intention and they're working towards making that intention happen. Let me give a specific example. In US, one of the TV shows which inspires me is Shark Tank. And I would see 80 to 90% of the Shark Tank ideas comes by the presenter will actually say, I had this problem. My friend had this problem. Okay, or my society had this problem and I wanted to solve it. So their intention that they want to solve that problem, make life better, is very high.
Right.
Okay, they're not telling, I know AI, so let me make a product with AI. No. Okay. I know databases, so let me make one database product. They don't go from what technology I know to what is there. Okay. So they identify good problems, and good problems are identified when you set an intention for yourself. So for them, their intention is, I want to have a happy life. So one of the things, to give a specific example, right? One person said she's very short. Okay. And she had a problem putting stuff on the top of her car. So she invented a small device, okay, which you put it into the doorknob. Or the, when you close the car door, right, it goes and gets locked somewhere. So they wanted a device which you just lock it in there. Okay, it's like a small step. So people who are short can step up on that and then put their luggage or whatever on top of the car. Simple use case, small product. She's selling $1 million worth of that product, just that one clamp. Right, that's a zoom in. So there is a very specific real problem. Right. And when you zoom into that, the market is itself high. So I think one of the challenges that we face as IT is basically we don't own any problem. The problem is somebody else's.
Okay.
The technology industry is just handed out a problem. It is not the technology industry's problem. It's somebody else's problem. And I'm solving. Right? I'm not even solving. Usually that guy comes with a solution. I just have to do the IT version of that solution. So this shift will happen when we, as a technology industry, start owning problems.
Since you mentioned that we don't do that, and it's not like that we, it's a lack of trying. I've seen a lot of efforts on things like, let's take ERP, for example, which is core to all enterprises, right? And there's been a very good ERP solution from India for a very long time, Ramco, right? Ramco. They have done that for a long time, right? Still, even in India, most enterprises would rather go to SAP or PeopleSoft or you name it, ERP, rather than go to Ramco. So that is what I'm thinking from the perspective of a company which has grown up in India, which is based on real problems which Indians have faced. But at some time, I guess Ramco also just converted to an MNC in that sense that we want to target the world rather than India. So why do you think that has happened? It's not that there is not enough problem solving there. And the famous Indian Jugaad, right? Jugaad is, in my view, is all about problem solving, and problem solving in that personal sense that I need to solve this problem for myself and I do this. And you are, at some place you call it innovation, in some places they call it Jugaad, right? So what I'm trying to understand is, why is it that Jugaad or that approach for Indian companies has not succeeded at a large scale, even within India? I'm not forget about the rest of the world, right? So I'm saying even within India, Ramco is not the most used ERP, right? Although it's very much based in India, created in India company, and probably maybe, I don't know, five times cheaper than SAP, for example, right? I don't know. I have no financial knowledge of that. But is there a reason behind why they have not succeeded?
Obviously, there has to be a reason. Yeah. We will. What we can do is, so let's take. Let me take a success story.
Yeah.
Okay. Tally.
Yeah.
Okay. Extraordinarily successful.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. Yes.
Now what's, so I'm just looking at what made Tally successful, right? Tally was extraordinarily cheap compared to the problem it was solving.
Yes.
Okay. And it was very obvious.
Right.
10,000 rupees, 15,000 rupees, okay? But there is a problem in accounting, okay? And it had things where you could have undocumented account. So things like that were also a part of that.
Okay? Yes.
Localized, okay?
Yes.
Now, that is an extraordinarily successful product even today. Any small guy starts a company, he doesn't mind spending for Tally.
Yes.
Okay. And they were able to also, I don't know the details, but they have been able to get the ecosystem also with them. That the first guy who talks for them, right?
Yes.
They've got that. They've got the accountants. They've got the chartered accountants, the guys who know account, right? To the extent that any accountant, any accounting course, Tally is one.
Number one, yes. Yeah.
It's one part in the curriculum.
Yes. Yes.
Okay. They've been successful in doing that. Now, today, let's take 2-3 companies which is very successful comparatively, right? SaaS providers, Zoho, Freshdesk, Freshworks, okay. These guys are Kissflow, okay. They are pretty successful, okay. Now it's kind of Zoho is a completely different, within this Zoho is a completely different animal because it's completely self-funded,
right?
Okay. And they have a plethora of projects around. Okay. Now I keep wondering, why haven't I actively picked that up compared to, let's say I'm using Google or something else, right?
Right.
Probably I think one, if I just take, I'm just talking for myself and I'm thinking, why didn't I use, I had Zoho email, but then we switched from Zoho email to this.
Gmail.
One thing is they still haven't solved how to handle the economy problem that way.
Which
within
is?
Within India. Like it has to be made dead cheap or like, for example, unthinkably cheap.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Something like, for example, see, there are a lot of companies today don't give email to their think we were talking about it yesterday.
Yes, yes.
Okay.
Yes.
If somebody offers email to them, like 5 rupees per user or 10 rupees per user per month, yeah, it'll work. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. We still don't have a company which is offering at that level.
Is it really that difficult? Is it really that difficult to provide a cheap service based on the level of cheap hardware to cheap labor to cheap everything which we have available? Is it because of the infrastructure is so expensive that we cannot really afford to offer those services that cheap? Or we are unwilling to try that, invest? Because if you look at means things like people like Swiggy or any of these new startups where literally they're losing money, means they're not making money. The Swiggy is not making money or Zomato is not making money. They're losing money hand over fist, right? And people are just investing money into those companies believing that they will one day change the world. But simple things like what you suggested, are people not willing to invest to create that market for local companies to be able to afford that really cheap?
I think it's one of the, probably the reason for that is it's a real challenge, okay, getting the economies down. So kind of people kind of say, you know, instead of going up to the Indian market, let me go outside.
Because there are practical reasons to do that, because they can show the revenue immediately and say this is the dollar is obviously better than the rupee. So.
And probably China, right? This is where that regime becomes advantageous. Boss, you cannot go outside. You have to sell only within India. So if government of India puts a rule, right? Any SaaS provider, you can sell only within India. I'm sure that will force us to think better.
Mm-hmm. So you're saying there needs to be some constraint put on people to innovate really
harder.
Think harder.
Yeah.
Because we have not really
problem.
Tried hard enough.
So we haven't tried hard enough. So we kind of take that path of, you know, let me go outside and then getting a $50 subscription, right, in US per user per month is a lot more easier than getting what 15 to 75 is what 3,500. Yeah, 3,500 rupees in India is like unfeasible, impossible.
Yes. Yes. Yeah, I mean that's sort of my question is that the technology to create, let's say, a simple service like a video conferencing service, which is very well understood. It's not like technically it's not rocket science anymore, right? You have at least 10 different services available to if you just want to do video conferencing, right? From the top of the line Polycon based video conferencing to right webcam based video conferencing, which we're doing now, right? And we're still, and a lot of these companies are offering for free, right? Now, even like Zoom made so much money after this, especially all this lockdown and all those things. And is it very difficult for an Indian company to do something which is priced in rupees and really cheap enough? Is Zoho really cheap enough in that sense? May just to ask you that question, since you considered Zoho.
See, I think I did not find Zoho cheap, right? Or let me say, putting it affordable.
Mm-hmm. It's not affordable for the kind of features they are providing. They are not pricing it economical enough. If they were like 1/10 the cost, I can live with less features.
See, right? I think one of the things is, right, like they offer a lot of services. It's a plethora of products. Okay.
Yes.
And I'm very impressed by what they have done. Okay.
Yes.
As a company, what they have done for themselves, what they have done for society. And it's completely internally funded. It's not like they are burning some venture capitalist fund there. Okay. So Zoho is very different from the other SaaS providers when we talk about. Other services have taken investor money and they are burning it, pumping it, getting used. But Zoho is purely on their own merit. When I say merit, it is hard cash coming in and based on that they are operating. Okay. Which is pretty good.
Right.
Okay. And that being said, I think the economics compared to, let's say, an Office 365 or this is not, it's nearly on par. In some cases, it becomes slightly expensive also, correct? And but the thing is, they do offer other services, right? Like, for example, they have an accounting, they have a CRM and things like that. Okay.
Right.
But somehow it becomes a little tricky, because what's happening is, like, it's like the Apple world. They have their own ecosystem also. I'm purely talking as a consumer here.
So they don't have too many integrations.
It's not obvious, at least, even with such technical guy, right? I'm not too comfortable getting into the Zoho world, because I feel I'll get into one universe and then get stuck there. It's a feeling that I'm having.
Okay, so it may or may not be true. So we don't know. Okay, okay.
Okay. But I'm kind of concerned about that feeling.
Okay. So we discussed all these problems, right? So is there a way out of it? Means how do we come out of this, I would say, quagmire, right? Because there are so many factors which are preventing this innovation from taking hold, right? So we have the product is maybe not as good, they may not have enough integration, but there is the price difference is not really appreciable for us to really invest in that, right? Although there might be a lot of quote-unquote patriotic Indians who want to buy from an Indian company, but they are not making it really worth their while to even consider it.
Right. So I think one of the challenges, or one way out, okay, is we need to zoom in to a specific problem. Take a very small problem. Okay, and try to solve that for a bunch of people. Okay, don't immediately start thinking 100 million users, 10 million users, 20 million users, like that. Okay,
right.
Because the technology company is enamored by that, right?
Yes.
The moment they start a company or a product, they'll say, how will I have 1 million users on this platform, and where do I get funding? And so they start off by telling, where do I get funding? If you talk to any startup or anything, right, 95% of their question is, how do I get funding? Okay. So, and how do I get to 1 million users? Without that, there's no point running a startup.
Okay. Right.
I think that is a very, that approach is very hard to get a good success, impactful thing. Okay. It's very hard. Not that it's impossible, but it's very hard.
So what you're suggesting is...
Take a very small problem. Solve it for, let's say, 1,000 people or 2,000 people, like that. And keep working on that till you reach that economy of scale. So what we call in the hypoha world is, do the value hypothesis. Show that this solution can be valuable to the end user. Once you have got that value very clearly established, then you go for growth hypothesis.
Yeah. I think this is a good point to study. I think I'm sure probably limitations of our knowledge and exposure to all the companies who are probably being innovative, and we don't have the knowledge of those companies be doing it. But this is purely based on what we are experiencing in our day-to-day life and our day-to-day business, how successful these companies are. And it may be a good point to study as to from how what you describe from the hypoa perspective, that how many companies have actually applied and probably reverse engineer the success story from hypoa perspective and do that as a study and say how that has actually really panned out, or is there a different perspective there?
That's a very good point, right? Now, if I look at some of the successful things who were very successful, right?
Yeah.
If you look at, let's look at some of the successful enterprises in India. I'm just talking about what comes to my mind. I'm sure there are many more.
Yeah.
If you take Tally, for example, right? They didn't think of scale and all. They said, there is an accounting problem, I'll just solve that. If those guys had been there during this time, I'm sure they might have also taken funding and got killed, or something would have happened. Okay.
Yes.
So they were at that point in time. They said, I have to make it cheap and I have to make it work.
Yes.
Okay. Another thing, have you heard of these Jyoti Laboratories?
Maybe. I'm not familiar with the product. If you tell me the product.
They call it blue, like that liquid blue.
Okay. Yeah, yeah. That is Robin Blue. Is that their product?
No, there was another product from them. So that company is called Jyoti Laboratory. So they started off by doing just that.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And then there is another company in Chennai, which actually came up with the sachet product, shampoo.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now that is a very classical example of, they said, we will give shampoos in sachet. Mm-hmm. Why did they come up with that? They said the common man cannot afford a 100 rupee shampoo bottle.
Right.
But he needs a shampoo.
Yeah. Give him 2 rupees sachet.
So they gave him a 1 rupee sachet, 2 rupee sachet. So that was their key. Of course, they made the product also cheaper.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. At that time, whoever were popular, right? They didn't even consider that. Now, this company became successful just by the virtue of sampling that.
Mm-hmm.
So they focused on that economy of getting that. Now, today, when you think of sachet, it's easy. But you got to think of it 30 years ago.
Yes.
When everybody was selling shampoos.
Yes.
And we say the common man cannot afford it. Is it too bad? That market doesn't exist for me.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. They came up with a sachet. All right. Because they chose the problem correct. They said, I will get that lower income guy to use shampoo. How? So that was their problem.
Right.
They didn't say, you know what, I have the technology, know how to make shampoo. How am I going to beat Lux or Pond's or whatever?
Right.
They said, I'm going to make the common man, that rickshaw guy, that guy on the street. I want to make him use the shampoo. How?
Yeah.
So that quality of problem. And that would happen only if we can do a zoom in. And we have to control that urge to scale out. And so value hypothesis, growth hypothesis. On day one, we want to have that growth and scale. So I think that's our Achilles heel or blind spot or something which drags us up.
Well, I think it is worthwhile to study how some of these things have been successful or unsuccessful. Maybe one of your mentees could take it up as a project to look we that could, up as
yeah. We could also look that, right? Like if just that when you're telling this, Dhirubhai Ambani, he started off, if I remember, by selling oil on his can and cycle, right? It's not that he was thinking of big industry and scaling out. And Jio Telecom, why did it become popular? They said, I will give phone at 1 rupee. So if you look at it, they're always going after that specific. That they put as the first thing. I will deliver my solution at economy.
Yes.
Rest comes later.
A lot of people actually did not realize at that point of time that when they were giving free services almost for 1 year, right? Jio actually literally gave free services for 1 year for the first few lakh customers or whatever, right? And people just rushed and formed queues to get it, right? And people did not understand what the economics behind all this thing is. Once you build that infrastructure, that is already going, it is depreciating day by day, right? And it is consuming power, right? And that is, so you might as well let people use it for free. You are buying customers by anyway. If you don't have customers, you will still be paying for power and storage and there's those equipment. The cost is a sunk cost, right? So,
So if you take that example, right, the kind of people kind of say, oh, they had a lot of money in the bank. Okay, there are a lot more industries which also have money in the bank, but they're not willing to take that risk,
right?
Because their clarity, right? No, I'm not commenting on whether it is good or bad, but there is a problem which an organization is willing to bet their stock on.
Right.
That's all. The conviction, this problem is a real problem and it needs a solution. So if you're convinced about a problem, then your conviction of the solution also goes higher.
So I think one of the things which I gather from you is that this focus, we have too much focus on how we provide services to rest of the world than to provide services to India, right? Or to people, means all the people who work in this IT industry. I would say 60 to 70% are focused on how they provide services outside of India.
And would that's you, because you... of the money. Because yeah, of that's the money. Easy, that's, because it's that, easy to sell.
Of course, right? It is easy to sell. Of course. Means I'm not saying the reason behind it, but that is, I'm saying that that's where the market is right now. And the only way we can actually probably come back to solving our own problems is when we start thinking of how we can, you see, and there is money in India to be made hand over fist. Means people will fall over themselves to buy your product if it is. Geo and Tally and all these are good examples of correct. That people are willing to pay if you solve the right problem for the right price.
Yes,
right?
Correct.
So all I'm seeing is today IT companies, especially enterprise IT companies, are not focused on India enough to solve India specific enterprise IT problems.
Correct.
Right. So that is and how that will happen, I mean, today I don't have the answer. Maybe constraints, maybe somebody gets enlightened and maybe we see one success story. Maybe Zoho comes to light and made their product more competitive as compared to whatever else they are selling, right? And they really shine and make it a success story for Indian companies, right? Because that is how people will start buying in the story, right? Otherwise, why should I invest in making some product for India when I might as well spend half the effort and sell it to the world, right?
Correct.
because solving the India problem is much more harder and requires much more investment as compared to probably established markets outside of India.
That's true. So,
right. So I think that was a very good discussion we had, and I know we didn't answer how to solve the problems, but I think we are coming closer to identifying the problem before we actually start solving it. And one of the things which we have understood is we have to zoom in, like you said, zoom in and try to solve a problem for people in India, for companies in India, and then and make sure India is a price sensitive market. But I would not say people are unwilling to pay for the right thing, right? It's people will pay for it if you make it really worth their while. And like Kumaran said, even today, nobody would want to buy a local product unless it is competitive against a worldwide available product, right? So that there is, and we will not compromise on quality, patriotic we may be, but we will not compromise on quality because finally it is your own hard-earned money which is being used for the product. And same thing applies for Indian companies. They will not go after some shabby Indian product when a competitive worldwide product is available. And it is most likely that worldwide product was created somewhere in India. At least parts of it was created in India.
Right? Correct.
Right. So thank you for listening. And we'll come back to you with another good topic. Please subscribe to our channel, listen to our podcast, and spread the word. And we are trying to find out ways to get more input from all of you. If you have questions which you want to talk about in terms of enterprise IT in India, please, you are welcome to talk to us on Facebook, on LinkedIn. The links are available easily. Search for Enterprise Tech India Unplugged, and ETIUnplugged.in is our website. Please make sure you go there and check out the latest episode. We come around at least once in 2 weeks. All right, and thank you very much for everything. Bye for now.